haven't seen a sunny day ever since he went away. Wonder when my baby's coming home. Haven't slept a wink at night, worrying if he's all right. Wonder when my baby's coming home.
The March 23, 1944 headline of the local newspaper, the Syracuse Herald-Journal, read, "Yanks hammer Nazi plane bases." The paper went on to tell how new raids were expected to boost the tonnage of Allied bombs dropped on Germany, and how American bombers blasted aircraft installations in northwest Germany. March 23, 1944 was a special date in the life of Frank G. Adams. It was the day his B-17 Flying Fortress, the Homesick Angel, was shot down while on a bombing mission in northwest Germany. It was the day Staff Sergeant Frank Adams became one of two survivors of the downed aircraft, and it was the day he was captured by the German Wehrmacht. The following is an oral history interview with Frank G. Adams of Syracuse, New York. The interview date is October 13, 2008. This is Jeffrey J. Lake interviewing Frank G. Adams at his home in Syracuse, New York. The date is October 13, 2008. Good morning, Frank.
Good morning, Jeff.
Frank, I'd like to first ask you, when and where were you born?
Here in Syracuse, New York, August 30th, 1920.
1920, so 88 years.
88, yeah, 88 years old now.
Wow.
Feel like an old man.
Was Syracuse a great place or a good place to grow up?
Well, I thought so. We lived up on the north side most all the time until the later years. But we lived up there until the 39 or 40, around in there.
Right.
And then after that, moved out of there. I got married and moved out of there.
Where did you go to, like, primary school, secondary schools?
I went to Grant Junior High School and that, and then things were so rough for the family. When I got through there, I dropped out. That was a junior high school.
Right.
I dropped out, and I didn't get my high school equivalency until I got back home after service.
Right. And what did you do, like, after school then? Did you go right to work somewhere?
Yeah, I worked, my job I had was with Hubbard Drugs. I used to deliver the drugs to the different drug stores, like all over the city.
So, okay.
And they'd called Hubbard Drugs and order drugs for different places, you know, stuff for the stores.
Now, Hubbard is still around?
They were not anymore. They used to live on Water Street, on the second 200 block of Water Street.
Right.
And I used to deliver the north side, and my buddy delivered the south side.
Right.
We played ball together and everything else. Had nice when I got called into service. And I had my daughter was born in July 19th
right.
of 42.
Right.
And I went into service then. And I went up to, I forget where it was, I went up to mechanic school and everything else out in the Midwest. And they wanted to keep me for instrument instructor.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, no, I want to stay with the guys I'm with, and wound up staying there.
Right.
And we went all over, down into Texas, and trained in Texas, and then up to California, went to school in California.
Right.
And then we flew out of Grand Island, Nebraska, right straight to Newfoundland. We landed in Newfoundland and then went all the way over to England. And then we flew our missions out of Paddington, out of England.
Right.
And
now, what year did you actually get to Paddington?
I can't think of the exact dates. 43, I think it was. 43 yeah. it was. I got to Paddington.
Mm-hmm.
And then we flew our missions out of there.
Right.
And was on our 19th mission is when we got shot down.
Right.
So we flew quite a few missions. We had a few exciting times there. Once they sent us out in the plane wasn't working right, we went back, and they checked the plane out and told us to take it up and check it, the skeleton crew.
Right.
come back to land it and come in. They sent us in downwind. We couldn't get down, couldn't get up, and finally went down, went off the end of the runway, and the plane nosed right up, the tail right straight in the air, and then down again. And nobody got hurt in it, but all I could think of was the navigator in the nose.
Right.
He had wires and everything all wrapped around him and everything else, but he didn't get hurt.
Turret gunners in there as well?
No, the turret gunners were back.
He wasn't
there. Didn't hurt him or anything else. Didn't hurt the...
But you were on that plane.
Yeah, I was on that plane, and that was... When they said, and just think, we got a load of bombs on here, and I took off down the runway because they never took the bombs off because oxygen and...
Sure.
And that hit together. I took off down the runway.
Never looked back.
They were laughing. I mean, it just wouldn't have done any good if you did, Frank. If that ever exploded, you wouldn't have got away from it. So.
Right.
But that happened. That was the first narrow escape we had.
Right.
And like I said, we crewed quite a few missions. We had a number of holes in the ship.
Right.
The B-17 was one tough plane to fly.
Now, the Homesick Angel was the G series.
Yeah, that's
which you had in March, right?
Yeah,
you had other planes prior to 44, basically.
Yeah. I forget what series, the F series, and that, and we wound up with the G series. That's what we had. One of the newer planes when we got hit.
And you flew missions where exactly? I mean, you flew some.
God. We flew up around Norway. We flew into Germany. Quite a few. Substations and submarine stations along the coast of France and down in there and all the way into Germany. And I was on the first, third, and fourth raids on Berlin itself.
Right.
That was a long run. I mean, you would be gone, start out in the morning, and by the time you got out there and got back,
well, we rendezvoused over to England.
Right.
And then
when
we took off, we'd use evasive action and then went into it and into Berlin. So I was in there, and the ACAC over Berlin was something else. I mean, it was rough. You were lucky to get out of there.
Right.
So.
And they were well sighted.
Oh, and how? they had the best anti-aircraft guns down there that I've ever seen.
And the biggest, I guess.
Biggest ones, and they really well they had to be prepped, and that was their main city, Berlin.
Right. So. Now you were flying at what elevation? Like 25,000 feet.
25,000 to 30,000 feet.
Right.
We varied in there. All depends on how it was, whether we had.
And that flak would hit that height.
Oh yeah, they'd get up there. They could get them pretty good. We used all kinds of evasive action and except when you got on the bomb run. Once you got on the bomb run, that was it.
You stayed right there
until you dropped the bombs, and then let's get out of here.
When you did a bomb run on a place like Berlin, how many ships were involved?
Oh, I can't tell you the numbers. When I went over, you could look out, and all you could see was 17s all around you. I mean, we had more 17s over there, just like the sky was full of B-17s.
Right.
And,
so you're talking hundreds or thousands?
Oh, hundreds, I'll say. Hundreds of them up there. Because we'd rendezvous over England and then take off.
Right.
And they used to say, and when we got home, like we the first thing we wanted to do was go into town to one of the pubs or something.
Right.
And we go into town and says, oh, you were on the mission today. Here's the rings of where your oxygen mask was on your face. So they knew we were.
So they could tell.
They could tell we were on the mission.
We'll get back to Syracuse for a minute because I want to talk a little bit about prior to the war.
Mm-hmm.
We know the United States is going to enter the war eventually in 1941-42.
Mm-hmm.
This is now 39 when it started. Germany invades Poland. What was Syracuse like back then? What were the feelings of war, and what were your personal feelings about war?
Well, at the time, we didn't even think anything about it. I mean, we knew we were at war and everything else, and just wondering if we were going to get called or drafted and stuff like that. But I was real active around here in sports and stuff like that all the time. And then being a boxing coach, I was on the boxing team and stuff like that. And we used to have shows here in Syracuse, which they don't anymore. And I just had some big amateur fights. I mean, top amateur fights. And we used to go all over. I used to go to Rochester and box sometimes. And
what age did you start the boxing, Frank?
16.
So at 16 you started. 16. How did that start? You told me a little story earlier.
Yeah.
What happened when you were 16?
We lived down on the north side, and there were all a bunch of kids that we hung together and everything else, and it come out in the paper that we're having the Golden Gloves. And somebody in the neighborhood took and entered my name in the Golden Gloves. And I didn't even know about it until they said, "Hey, Frank, I see you're fighting in the Golden Gloves." I am. And they had my name listed in the paper, so me, they only put my name in there. I says, "Well, I'll go ahead and do it."
So you didn't back down?
I didn't back down, so I went in, but that was a mistake. And I learned my lesson.
So how did you do in your first fight?
The first fight, I got knocked on my butt, and that was it. I went down, and it was like a punch in the chest. I went down, and I'm trying to get up, and the canvas didn't want to go away from me, so they counted me out. So after that, I went in and went back to the YMCA, and the coach there at the YMCA, he trained me for one solid year. Then I knew what the heck boxing was about and what to do instead of going in there straight.
Where was your gym then?
In the YMCA.
YMCA building downtown.
On Madison. Yeah, we're on Montgomery Street.
Montgomery Street in Syracuse, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's where we were. And trained me for a full year, and I went in. And like I say, when I went in the Golden Gloves next year, it was an entirely different thing. In fact, 2 years in a row, I wound up in the finals in the Golden Gloves and lost on a split decision both times.
Oh, goodness.
So,
what personalities did you meet back then in boxing? Any famous people?
No, only the different ones around there. I mean, afterwards is when I really got to meet the people. I got involved in working with New York State Athletic Commission, and I got with Billy Backus and Carmen Basilio and all those fellows I got to work with.
And they became really good friends
afterwards. Oh, real good friends. Right. In fact, Billy, I talk to him every once in a while. He's in South Carolina now.
Good.
And in fact, I wound up being elected to president of Ring 76, a national veteran boxing group. And Billy was my secretary treasurer. So,
good.
So we got along pretty good together, and always have. I met a lot of top knot fighters, Gene Fulmer and stuff like that. I even got a cap here that I was up to visit the Hall of Fame this past summer.
Right.
Gene says, "Give me your cap, Frank." And, he took my cap. He's the one to beat Carmen Basilio for the middleweight title.
Nice. You've got his signature. Look at that. On a Syracuse Big East hat. Look at that, huh?
Yeah.
Nice.
So, I've got quite a few friends there, and I've had some. I went into officiating, and I refereed quite a few good fights.
Well, that's how I knew you through the years. Yeah. Was your referee, and I was doing boxing physicals and so forth with Dr. Sincotta.
Dr. Sincotta, yeah.
Dr. Marola, through the years.
And I used to love it, and then afterwards they got so many young referees and that, so I said, well, I'll drop out and go as judge. And since then, I've been to Madison Square Garden three or four times or five times, and Montreal, Canada, and I've been all over officiating different fights and stuff like that.